and welcome to Milford, Merrick Alpert.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I came here tonight first to show you what a real live underdog looks like. I just want you to be able to see one. I'll be sensitive to your time. There are three things that I'd like to do this evening over the next few minutes. First, I'd like to tell you who I am and about the journey that has brought me before you tonight. And then what I'd like to do is share with you the day I decided to run, because I think it will give you insight into my vision and values. And then third, what I'd like to do is share with you the three issues I talk about every night across the state of Connecticut with Democratic town committees: private sector job creation, clean government, and getting out of Afghanistan. So to begin with, my name is Merrick Alpert. I was born in Hartford, and I was raised in Colchester by a single mother. My father left when I was a little boy, and I never saw him again, and we struggled. My mother worked as a school teacher in the public school system, and for a second job, she cut bread at the Colchester Bakery to make ends meet and provide for my brother and my sister and myself. For those of you in this room who are old enough, I owe thanks. Because of you, you loaned me the money to go to the University of Connecticut. Because even though I work construction and my mom worked two jobs, I couldn't afford to go without you. Eventually, I graduated from college and law school. And when I graduated, I thought I owed something back. And so I enlisted in the U.S. Army. Eventually, I earned a commission. And I volunteered and became part of a special operations helicopter unit. In 1998, I volunteered as an individual and went over to Bosnia. Many of you remember what you saw on television. Well, for me, it wasn't television. For me, it was real. For 6 months, I was on the ground as a U.S. peacekeeper in that Muslim nation. And I can tell you from firsthand experience, with your beard grown out and your weapon concealed in civilian clothing and a small squad with you, when you go village to village in a Muslim nation, you learn a lot about yourself. You also learn what American force and firepower can achieve, and you learn the limitations of American force and firepower. When I got home, along with a buddy of mine, we started a small company, a medical software company. For the first 2 years, we didn't get paid. I slept on an air mattress on a floor. Through a lot of hard work and through luck, we were able to grow that company and make it succeed. And eventually my partners bought out my share. I had been involved in politics and government from the time I was little. I had worked for Al Gore back in 1987 before he was a Nobel Prize winning rock star when he first ran for president. I worked for the Clinton-Gore campaign and for Gore on the campaign, on the inaugural, and the healthcare campaign. 16 years ago tonight, I was out in the state of Oklahoma fighting for a national healthcare campaign. In the 2000 race, when Gore was running for president, the election many of us still think he won, one night, while Gore was sleeping in the next room out in a hotel where we were in California, into the staff room walked a woman who I thought was the most intelligent, striking, beautiful person I'd ever seen in my life. And for hours, I tried to convince her to just go on one date with me, just one date. And I am pleased to say today that woman, Alex, is my wife, and we have three little children and live in Mystic. I say I'm probably the only man in America today to look at Al Gore and think romantic thoughts. And my wife tells me to quit saying that. I want to take a minute and share with you the day I decided to run. It started off in our home in Mystic. At the time, we had two little children. Alex was pregnant with our third. And I went from the house that morning to Hartford, to the barber who's cut my hair for about 25 years. And I listened to him tell me about the challenges of his small business and of his family and his customers. And I listened to him to tell me that for all those career politicians who always said Hartford would get better, Hartford never got better. And then I drove up Route 2 to that little house in Colchester where my ma still lives, where for many of my 43 years I lived, for the place that was always home. For those of you who come from working class people, you know what their hands look like. My mom has those hands. Hands that have earned every dollar that's ever passed through. When I walked in, my mom is older now, and she struggles to get around. She was sitting in a chair. And when I walked in, there she was in the kitchen. And she had a piece of paper in her hand. It was her retirement account. And my mom looked up from that piece of paper, and she said to me, "Merrick, half of everything I've ever worked for is gone." And I think more than any fact or figure, more than any statistic, more than any talking head on TV or words from some career politician, those words cut to the bone. Because here you have somebody for me that represents everything that's good about this state and about this country, and somebody who clearly had been betrayed by Washington and Wall Street. I drove home, and that night Alex and I tucked our two kids into bed. We did what everybody does. We read to them. We teach them, tell the truth, take responsibility for your action, be accountable, what everybody does. And when the kids were asleep, we went into our bedroom and turned the TV on. And there in our own bedroom, playing itself out in front of us was the collapse of the American economy and the American banking system. And I'll tell you something, watching all those men and women in Washington who've raised tens of millions of dollars to get there and stay there in perpetuity, I didn't see one of them do what I teach my kids to do. Because they didn't take responsibility for their action and they didn't tell the truth. I find it pretty amazing that for all those men and women, Democrat and Republican, not one of them was responsible for what they did to all of us in this room. Pretty striking. In the weeks that followed, I traveled the state. I met with a lot of members of Democratic town committees, I met with small business owners, I met with independents, and I met with Republicans. And I realized that what I had seen that day, that wasn't an anomaly, it was something that all of us were going through together. So on May 19th, with my friends and family next to me, I stepped out on the front porch of our house, and with a bank of TV cameras in front, announced I'd be running for the U.S. Senate. I'm running for the U.S. Senate because I want a progressive Democrat to win this seat, and I don't want Linda McMahon from World Wrestling to buy it. There are three issues I talk about every night. Number one, private sector job creation. I listen to career politicians jib-jab off a bunch of talking points about creating jobs. I listen to it all day long. I have a unique skill. I've actually created jobs. As Democrats, we know the best social welfare program ever created is a good private sector job. And contrary to what the Republicans might want to pin on us, we realize that before you can redistribute wealth, somebody actually has to create that wealth. And we need to invest in everything we know that has worked in the history of this country for job creation. Investing in education, investing in infrastructure, and targeting certain industries with investment. The second thing I talk about each night is clean government. When you are out there in your pickup truck, driving from town to town, running a grassroots campaign the way I am, you understand just how much money you have to raise and just what the advantage somebody has is willing to take PAC money and all the other money that flows into Washington. We need to do three things. First, we need publicly financed federal elections. Second, we need term limits. I don't think it helps any of us to send these folks on to government for longer than Moses and the Israelites wandered in the desert. It helps them, but it doesn't help us. If that system worked, we'd be in a much better situation tonight than we are. And finally, I think you need to take special interest money out of politics, specifically banking and financial services industry money. In this last election cycle, when you look at financial services, banks, insurance companies, those folks put in about $200 million in campaign contributions to federal elections. $200 million. And they didn't do it because they like these fellas' haircuts. They did it to buy an outcome. And guess what? All of us are paying for that outcome. For a long time, we Democrats have wagged our finger at Republicans and said, "You're the darlings of Wall Street. You're on the take." But as a Democrat in front of a room of Democrats tonight, I'm embarrassed to say, guess what? We Democrats, we took more money from the financial services industry in the last cycle than the Republicans did. This isn't their problem. It's our problem. And finally, I'm running for the Senate because of Afghanistan. I have a unique skill set. It's one that no other Democrat or Republican in this race has or will ever have, because I've actually served on the ground as a U.S. peacekeeper in a Muslim nation. You don't need to see a lot of mass graves or orphanages to have that impact you. I could tell you from firsthand experience, the course we're on is not in our national security interest, and it is not in our economic interest. I am much more interested in rebuilding Connecticut than Kabul. To emphasize my point, several months ago, I walked across the state of Connecticut, 117 miles. On a Tuesday morning at sunrise, I started on Route 1 on the Rhode Island border, and I started walking. After 4.5 days and 117 miles, I crossed into the state of New York. As a Boston Red Sox fan, I've never been so happy to see entering New York in my entire life. Let me finish by telling you what I saw on my journey. I started off for the sole purpose of expressing my opposition to the war. But within minutes, the walk became about something different, something bigger. When you are out there carrying your flag, walking across the state on Route 1, you're going pretty slowly, going about 3 miles an hour. You see a lot of things you don't see at 65 miles per hour in a car. You go so slowly that when you're walking, on the telephone poles, you can see the staples in the telephone poles. You can see those little bits of paper beneath the staples. Let me tell you what I saw. I saw a lot of businesses that are no longer in business. I saw a lot of them boarded up. And a lot of those boards, those are fresh boards. They hadn't even weathered one Connecticut winter. I walked over roads and bridges that were crumbling. On day 3, I crested the hill looking out over New Haven Harbor and the city beyond. And I saw a city where nearly 50% of the minority students will never graduate from high school. In my state, in my nation. And yet, for all of the pain and suffering I saw out there, for all of the hurt, I saw really strong people. I saw an old man, after I'd been out there for a couple of days, who saw a piece on the news the night before, and he stood out in the cold and the wind with a bottle of water waiting for me. He stood out there in front of his store, and he went a little ways with me, just a few steps. And he said, Merrick, I'm too old to walk with you. But keep going. You're doing the right thing, and I'm with you. My name is Merrick Alpert. I represent the Democratic wing of the Democratic Party. And my intent, with your vote and your support, is to be the best employee you ever have. Thank you.
Questions for Merrick.
Yes, sir.
Oh, Merrick.
Yes, sir.
Job creation in the private sector, complex issue.
Yes, sir.
So could you, bring it down to basics a little bit and tell us where would be step one?
Yeah, the step one, because of the situation we're in tonight, has to be an emergency step. That's really twofold. First, we need to have a massive jobs creation program. We don't. As you saw a few days ago, moving through Congress is a much, much smaller bill than we should have. The second piece, beside having, I think, a much more significant job creation bill, is to flow access to credit for small businesses. I've met with dozens and dozens of businesses across the state who have made it very clear to me, two last week, in fact, in the New Haven area, made it very clear that their customers can't access the credit market, smaller customers. These guys make steel products. And so the customers want to resupply, want to buy the product from Connecticut companies so they can resupply them their inventory. And yet, they don't have access to the credit markets to be able to do it. In a down cycle where you don't have the strong cash flows coming in from customers, that credit becomes the survival mechanism. And I know that because every business that I built, you know, you go through that in the early phases of the business. So I think immediately it's got to be a job creation bill and flowing access to credit. Longer term, it's infrastructure investment, educational investment, and then investment in targeted industries. If you're looking at stem cell research, if you're looking at bio components, if you're looking at all the green energy components, wind, solar, hydro, thermal, that's how we can get ahead. I mean, Connecticut at the end of the day has the ability to go out there and drive these technologies. But without someone who understands this stuff and has done it before, I think we're leaving this to chance, and we know where chance has gotten us. Yes, sir.
I have a question for you. I don't want to draw a meeting out. Another guest speaker. On Afghanistan, I was a little troubled with what you said about Afghanistan.
Yes, sir.
And I'd just like you to clarify to me what you mean by that. Yeah. I know about not rebuilding Kabul, but what do you mean about, like, you want to get out of Afghanistan, stay out of it?
Yeah.
And what about the Osama bin Laden and some of the Al-Qaeda that have been training there for years and going back in there.
Yeah.
How do you expect to address that?
Thank you. It's a great question. The policy that I embrace here is called continual asymmetric containment. What it recognizes is the fact that this is a new type of warfare, a warfare that our strategies on the ground have not embraced. It means we don't send 100,000 uniformed troops to a place like that. But instead, we launched the way we launched in phase one, what was called Operation Jawbreaker. 350 special operating troops, 100 paramilitaries out of Langley, and then 15,000 members of the Northern Alliance that a man named Massoud, who had been killed 2 days before 9/11, put together. That way, the footprint on the ground is going to be a Muslim footprint. They're going to live in the villages and speak the local languages, speak the dialects, and obviously they look the part. It's going to minimize your U.S. combat casualties, and it's going to allow you to kill and capture terrorists, but in a much more effective way. What we're doing right now is hitting the hornet's nest, but not killing the hornets. And that's what's got us into this situation. I fundamentally believe we're in a much worse situation from a national security perspective than before this started. Now, part of the reason for that, as you know, is because we went into Iraq when we should not have. But at the end of the day, we've got a situation now where I think we can handle it much more effectively. I would finish the answer by saying this. If you look at the basic elements of counterinsurgency and what you have to do effectively to engage counterinsurgency, you see first and foremost that you need a legitimate, competent government that can be stood up. If you look at Hamid Karzai, he's both corrupt and incompetent. His brother Walid is heavily involved in the illegal opium trade, the illegal timber trade, and the illegal land seizure trade. You also need a kill zone. You need to set a box up. And it's not polite conversation, but I want to be very honest in answering this. Because from my perspective, if this is what our forces are engaged in, your elected officials need to stand in front of you and tell you it. When you set up the kill box, you want to make sure in counterinsurgency that you don't have movement out of the zone. Unfortunately, if you look at the situation along the tribal area and then the actual Pakistani border, there's fluid movement back and forth. And so what's currently happening is that the ISI, the Pakistani CIA, is flowing millions of dollars that we send them in both cash and weaponry to the Afghan Taliban. You'll recall, of course, that the Pakistanis and the ISI established the Afghan Taliban as a counterbalance against India in that region. And so finally, I would say that when you look at our own counterinsurgency manual, our FEMA manual, when you do the calculations, there's a calculation table that shows you how many thousand troops you need per million in that population center. The population is roughly 28.4 million in Afghanistan. When you do the calc table off it in the counterinsurgency manual that General Petraeus just put together, it shows you need roughly 568,000 U.S. troops on the ground. At peak, as you know, at peak, we'll have 100,000 U.S. That's after we flow 30,000 more. And there'd be 35,000 NATO. You saw the Dutch government just collapsed over this issue. And whether it's the Dutch, whether it's the Germans, whether it's the English, whether it's any of those nations, they're going to pull out of this thing and not send more combat troops. But assuming for a moment you had 135,000 members of that alliance, your own field manual tells you you have to have
568,000. So I would point at our own documents to say that our own generals are telling us this is not viable. Thank you for the question. Yes, ma'am.
One more, Pat.
Okay. I work at the VA, my job at the VA is to find employment for our returning soldiers. How do you think you're going to help that, and how prepared are you for when the war does end, and we certainly hope it does, then they come home?
First of all, thank you for what you do. My view is this. Having served in the military, I think the military is absolutely fantastic at training people for their MOS, their military occupation specialty, to go into the military. We take a young man or woman who has never flown in a helicopter, and a year later, year and a half later, they fly a helicopter. Right? It's pretty amazing training, pretty amazing stuff. What the military is terrible at is, as you know, the end of that process. Right? When your tour of duty ends, in my view, what we need to do is set up a training phase where we train these men and women for several months to move from the military into the civilian sector. We've never done that in a significant way, as you know, and you see the ramifications every day. Now look, we got serious problems. I mean, we got serious problems with the physical ailments, as you know, the PTSD. I mean, I sit with these folks, right?
That's what I work with.
Right? Exactly. And at the same time, we're not making their lives any easier because we're not setting up their transition back into civilian life, right? That's what we need to do much more effectively. I am of the belief that as you put together a massive jobs creation program, part of what you do is extend out by several months those tours of duty. But those tours are going to be here with their families, reorienting to society, and then getting the necessary training and education they need to make a fluid flow back into a civilian workforce. But at the end of the day, there have to be jobs for them to go to, and the danger right now is we take the toughest, bravest folks, they get back from being overseas in Iraq or Afghanistan or somewhere else, and then lo and behold, there's no job for them. So in my view, that has to be job one for us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.